Hello everyone, welcome to the audiobook. This is Surekha Ramachandran. Today's book is Out of Time, Book 2. Okay guys, let's go inside the book.
Chapter 4, Ruth. Ali, Vic and Max walked as confidently as they could through the colorful corridors of the ship, trying to pretend they belonged there. They passed a family dressed like the other people Ali had seen, and they saw more crew members. No one questioned why the three kids were there, but they got a lot of funny looks. Ali even saw one little boy move closer to his parents as they passed, like he was afraid of them. After walking down what felt like the world's longest hallway, Ali began to smell something delicious, just as she would hope she would. "I smell ham," she whispered to the boys, "and cinnamon apples. You know, Luna would love that." "Follow the smell," Max said, raising his fist. "Find the dog." They turned the corner and the delicious, sweet and savory odor grew stronger. Ali figured the set of double doors right ahead of them would lead to a galley, but instead of seeing Luna waiting outside the doors, like Ali had hoped, she saw a young girl with a huge bow in her hair. The girl was trying to peek through one of the little round windows. "That's not Luna," Vic said. "Who is Luna?" the girl asked, spinning around. Her dress trilled as she turned to face them. "Oh," she looked the three of them up and down and tried to stop herself from laughing. "Luna is a puppy. She lost somewhere on the ship," Ali explained, suddenly feeling even more out of place in her jeans and sneakers. "We were hoping she would follow the delicious smells coming from the galley." Ali introduced herself and the boys to the girl. The girl replied, "I am Ruth. I follow those smells too. Sometimes the waitstaff sneaks me a snack." She grinned and gave them a funny look. "Where are you three from?"
"Philadelphia, Pennsylvania," Max answered.
"What room are you in?" Vic looked around the passageway for a hint. But before he had to come up with an answer, Ruth said, "I am in second class with my mother and brother, who is sick. We are taking him to America to see a good doctor. But my mother's real nervous about the ship, so I have to sneak out to explore. My father will be coming later on another boat." Ali knew the Titanic had three classes. The more money a passenger had paid for their ticket, the higher up on the ship they got to stay. And the higher up they were, the more likely
they were to get off the ship before it sank. But not many people survived the sinking. The more she thought about it, the more nervous Ali felt. Just as she was starting to think that they should warn Ruth about what was going to happen, the galley door swung open. A waiter dressed all in white and carrying a large tray full of plates of ham, bread and baked apples came out, looking surprised to see the four of them standing there.
"Little lady, I told you no more sneaking up here," he said to Ruth. "You are going to get both of us in trouble, especially if you start bringing friends."
"They belong here. They are first class," Ruth said, crossing her arms. The waiter looked at Ali, Vic and Max, shook his head and laughed. "Doubtful," he said, but he handed them each a good-sized piece of ham and a slice of bread and quickly went on his way.
"What? No apples?"
Max asked, his mouth full of food. "Are you brothers and sisters?" Ruth asked as she chewed.
"Max is our friend," said Ali. "Max is my friend." Vic put his arm around Max. Ruth put her arm around Ali. "Then you are my friend. Pretty sure we can all be friends, guys." Max swallowed his last bite and wiped his hand on his pants. Then he looked at Ruth and seemed worried. "Well, sort of." Ali knew that Max was thinking the same thing she was. Everyone on the ship was in danger and they had no idea, but it was hard to focus on that with her stomach growling so loudly. She hadn't realized how hungry she was until she had the warm bread in her hands. Time traveling must make you hungry, she thought. However, even though it tasted delicious and she wanted to savor every last bite, she knew it would be the perfect bait to catch Luna with. The boys and Ruth ate all of theirs, but Ali tucked half of hers into her pocket.
"You can get all the food you want up in first class," Ruth said. "You don't have to save it. It's treat for Luna. We have to find her or we are never going to get home," Ali said. She thought they should warn Ruth before they went on their way to look for Luna, or Ruth would never get home either. "There is something we should tell you," said Ali.
"The Titanic..."
"Wait," Vic shouted, making Ali jump. Don't. Why not? Because haven't you ever heard how it's bad to try to change history? It could have ripple effects all through the time that we don't even know about.
Yeah, but the ripples might be good in this case, said Ali.
What on earth are you all talking about? Ruth asked.
What ripples?
We will explain later, Vic said. Let's go look for Luna.
Ali was angry at her brother for not letting her tell Ruth what would happen to the Titanic, but she thought Vic might be right about the ripple effects. Still, when they looked at each other, Ali knew that they were all wondering the same thing. Would Ruth ever make it to America?
Chapter 5. Dog gone again. Tell me what Luna looks like, Ruth said, and I will help you find her. Black and white, four legs and a tail, Vic said. Ali rolled her eyes. He always thought he was so funny. She is all that and super soft with big, beautiful brown eyes, and she loves to run and chase her tail. You can say that again, Max said. She has a tiny bit of white at the very end of her tail, like a paintbrush dipped in paint. Also, she loves shoes. He lifted up his sneakers and showed Ruth his chewed up laces. All right, Ruth said. Let's find this puppy. Ali still wanted to warn Ruth about the disasters that was coming, especially now that she was going to help them find Luna. Even though she agreed with Vic for now, she still planned to let Ruth know she was in
danger before they went home. But they couldn't get home without Luna. Ruth knew the ship so well. She had them running through beautiful ballrooms, decadent dining hall, art galleries, libraries, and even a room with a swimming pool. They entered an ornate dining room where most of the people ignored them as they squeezed past their conversations and dinner parties. Everywhere the kids looked, there were brightly polished things. Ali had never seen so many shiny things, silverware, vases, even the walls themselves.
Mom and Dad would go crazy here, Vic said as they examined shelves of plates and bowls in every color. And none of it even has to be dusted, said Max, running his finger over a silver teapot that looked awfully familiar to Ali. In fact, it looked like it matches the tea set she would been polishing that morning. It must have been the missing teapot. Her mom would be so excited. Ali reached out to pick it up when someone shouted behind them, "Do not touch the fine silver." The kids all swung around to see a woman wearing an enormous feather hat and a ruffled lace dress. "What are you staring at?" she asked. "You don't even belong in the dining room, you hooligans. What kind of parents let their children run all over the place dressed in? Well, whatever it is you are wearing." "Sorry, ma'am," Ruth said. "We are trying to find my friend's lost dog." "Of course you are," the woman said. "By any chance, is this dog black with white paws?" "Yes," Ali said. "Have you seen her? Does this dog like to steal things?" "That's Luna," Ali said. "What did she steal this time?" Vic asked.
"Whatever it was, I hope she didn't eat it," Max said. The woman held up a white glove. "The match to this, I was lounging on the top deck when the furry blur ran through and knocked over everyone's glasses with her tail. She ran up to me and looked me right in the eye as if she was saying, 'Hello there, Miss Molly Brown. I am going to steal your glove now.' And that's exactly what she did. Snatched it right off my lap." "That's definitely Luna," Alice said. "She is really a very friendly dog." "She mostly likes to be chased," Max added. "Yes, well, it worked," Molly Brown said. "I tried to catch her, but she was too fast. She likes to chase her tail a lot, too." "Oh, no," Ali said. "What if she spun in circle again and left us here?" "How could she leave?" Ruth asked. "We are in the middle of the ocean. I'm sure she is around here somewhere."
"Don't worry, we will find her." "I hope you are right," Max said, "because if not, we are all doomed." Vic elbowed Max in the arm. "Shh. I don't think it's a good idea to say anything, remember?"
"I don't know. Wait, the more I think about it, wouldn't it be a good thing?" Max whispered. "Save everyone on the Titanic. Save ourselves if we can't find Luna. Hasn't it anyone ever told you that whispering is a rule?"
"And save us from what?" Molly Brown asked. "The likes of you four?" She laughed and laughed as though this were the funniest joke
anyone had ever told.
Come on, guys, Ali said. We are running out of time. She grabbed Ruth by the sleeve and ran back into the passageway. Behind her, Molly Brown called out, Bring me back my glove when you find her. I will be reading on the upper deck. Yes, ma'am, Ruth called out. I like that lady, she said. But why do Vic and Max think they have to save everyone on the Titanic? We will explain later, Alice said. I promise. She felt horrible about not telling her new friend the truth.
The boys joined them in the passageway and the four of them tried to decide where to look next. They didn't have to think for too long because right up ahead, they saw a dark blur dash out of one room and into the next. Luna! There she is, Alice shouted. As they ran towards the room, they saw someone else come out and run after Luna too. It was a woman dressed in purple and green with a red bag around her waist. Chapter 6 Out of Time. It's a lady from the store, Max shouted. They watched as the Juniper switched around a corner and was gone. Hurry up, cried Ali. She's going to get Luna before we do. We have to tell her we are here. Ali grabbed Max and pulled him down the passageway. With her, Ruth and Vic ran behind them. How is this even possible? Vic yelled as they ran. We left that lady on the sidewalk in Philadelphia, didn't we? I'm so confused. How did you get on the ship? Anyway, we left from England, not Philadelphia. Ruth seemed confused, but they couldn't tell by her grin that she was enjoying the crazy adventure she wouldn't gotten pulled into. None of them answered her, but she still followed them as they ran down the hall, following flashes of the woman's dress around corners through a dining hall and a music room, and then through a set of doors that opened to reveal a huge staircase that wrapped around the room. Ali, Vic and Max all gasped. Ruth led them up the steps, squeezing past couples coming down so they could look over the balcony. There was a beautiful dome window and a gigantic chandelier hanging above them. Ali thought it looks like something that belonged in a palace. Ruth said, Grand, isn't it? Down below, Luna wagged her tails at the woman in purple and green who was crouched down in front of her. Juniper was saying something to Luna that they couldn't hear. Ali noticed that she had another one of those glowing balls in her hand, just like the one Luna had swallowed, only this one was green, a second infinity spinner. Ali nudged Max and pointed. Max's eyes widened and he leaned over the railing. Hey lady, he shouted. Everyone around them stopped talking. Juniper startled and rose to her feet, but she held tightly on to Luna. You three made it here after all? She grinned. Ali couldn't figure out what she was so happy about. Here was not exactly a great place to be, but at least Luna hadn't spun off without them. She must not have chased her tail enough to go anywhere else. They all ran down to Luna. Ali bent down and hugged her. Don't ever run away again, sweet girl. Luna licked Ali's cheek and nibbled her ear. It was a way of apologizing. No glove, Ruth said. She probably ate it, said Vic, as Alice slipped Luna's collar back on. This dog probably has a whole department store in her stomach. I don't know how we will explain this one to the VET. He turned to Juniper. How exactly did we get here, anyway?
Did you send us away on purpose? Asked Max. Will the spinner still work to get us home? Asked Ali. Luna barked. What's going on? Ruth shouted over all of them. Several people stopped in their track to see what the fuss was all about, and Juniper ushered them to the edge of the room so they wouldn't attract any more attention. Listen, all of you, I don't have enough time to explain everything. Juniper started, but she was interrupted by a woman shouting, Ruthie, Elizabeth Becker, I have been
looking everywhere for you, young lady, and you are not supposed to be up here. Your brother is in the cabin waiting, and you know how I feel about this rickety boat. What possesses you to run off like this? And who are these awful children? She eyed Vic's sweatshirt like it was on fire and quickly pulled Ruth to her side. At that, Juniper looked Ali, Vic and Max right in their eyes. I can't stay. There is someone I have to find before he finds you. Go get that silver teapot. Get your dog to spin 5 times. Get home. She looked worried for a moment, but then she put her hands on Ali's shoulders and whispered, I know you can do this. It's what you were born to do. Trust me. And then she ran up to the stairs, spun around 5 times and vanished. Ruth's mother looked like she might faint. Please wait, Ali yelled. But it was too late. Juniper was gone. Ali wanted to cry.
Someone was after them and Jennifer left them behind. Max squeezed Ali's hand. It will be okay, he said. She's right, we have got Luna. But now we need a teapot, Vic asked, scratching his head. I don't get it. Ali knew exactly which teapot they needed, although she didn't understand why. But before she could tell Vic, she noticed Ruth's mother quickly leading Ruth away. I didn't even say goodbye to my friend yet, Ruth said. Too bad, her mother said. We are
going back to our cabin right now. Ruth waved as her mother guided her away. It was nice to meet you. Glad you got your dog back. Maybe I will see you in America. Wait, Ali called after Ruth. But Ruth's mother held up her hand to stop her. That's enough, child, she said and whisked Ruth away. Ali felt sick to her stomach. They would never had a chance to explain to Ruth what was going to happen to the Titanic. Now Ali really felt like crying, but she blinked back the tears as best she could. What time is it? She asked Vic, wiping her face dry. What does that matter? I don't even know what day it is. Vic rubbed his face. He watched as Ali hooked the leash back onto Luna's collar, making sure it was tight enough that the puppy wouldn't slip out of it again. Luna licked Ali's hand. Is time even a thing anymore? Asked Max. If you are trapped in 1912?
The ship hits an iceberg late at night, almost midnight, I think, Ali whispered.
I remember learning in class that so many people were already in bed when it happened that a lot of them never knew anything was wrong until it was too late. No one thought this ship could sink even when it was in trouble. If we go after Ruth now, we can still warn her before it's too late. We don't even know what room she is in, said Vic. Well, then we can just knock on every door and warn everyone, Ali said. A giant clock chimed.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. We have to move fast, Ali said, gripping Luna's leash tightly. If tonight is the night the Titanic sinks, we are running out of time.
Hello everyone. I hope you guys enjoyed this Out of Time book 1 and book 2. We will meet in next book 3. If you like this audiobook, please click the like button and subscribe it. Thank you.